Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse is in theaters worldwide right now, and I could not be more excited that the world finally gets to see this movie, and that it is as great as I've always known that it's going to be. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is one of my favorite movies of all time. I think it's one of the greatest Spider-Man movies of all time, one of the greatest animated movies of all time. It's just a fantastic movie, a celebration of the character, and a celebration of the character of Miles Morales, his introduction to the theatrical experience through an animated movie. What better way to kick off his theatrical existence? Because that movie is absolutely phenomenal, and its sequel is definitely no different. This movie elevates everything past any level that I thought was possible. It goes bigger, but it also goes deeper, which is what all great sequels do. They expand upon where the first one ended, they take the next logical step, they take things and elevate them to the next level, but they also go down to a deeper level. We get to know what makes these characters tick. These characters are forced to be in scenarios where they have to make choices that cause them to evolve as characters. They change, they grow, and they move even closer to becoming the best possible versions of themselves. It laughs in the face of modern cinema and the Marvel Cinematic Universe even, as it takes things about superhero movies that usually get kind of criticized and it turns them into its greatest strengths, and I'm going to explain that in today's video. If you haven't seen Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, I would suggest clicking away now because I'm going to move into spoiler territory. So if you don't want to have the movie spoiled for you, go watch it. Trust me, it's worth your time. It's a phenomenal experience. One of the greatest movies ever made, as I've said multiple times. So you should definitely go check it out if you haven't already. With that said, let's go ahead and get right into the video. There are three points about this movie that I want to touch on what makes it one of the greatest movies that has ever been put to the silver screen.
And then I looked at my uncle and...
Let me guess. He died.
Starting off, we have the animation style. Now, this movie is Lord & Miller production. They have their own production company, I think, now, which is pretty cool. They are always pushing the medium of animation farther than anyone ever thought possible. First with the Lego movie, which kind of made a whole new style of animation for that movie. They experimented with how to make Legos look real and look like it was maybe even a stop motion film. And I know people who still think that the Lego movie was a stop motion production, which used real Legos to make the movie, which is pretty sweet. And they just pushed the medium of animation, you know, playing with different frame rates and animation styles. And they just really elevated the animation industry with that movie. And they did it yet again with Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, which was a Sony Pictures animation film, which used this kind of rubber hose cartoony style, and there was exaggerated expressions and movements, and that movie really also played with a lot of things in animation that people don't usually think to mess around with, but Lord & Miller, with their creative absolute genius, decided to mess around with that and push the medium of animation even further. The movie Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse still has the animation community reeling from how great that movie was, and especially how they used their style of animation that they used to make it look like a comic book come to life and use different frame rates, and they kind of combined everything that they'd experimented with the Lego movie and with Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, and they, you know, just took it to a whole other level, to where that movie is one of the most beautiful movies ever made still, until we got this movie, which kind of topped it, in my opinion. You have Miles Morales and his main comic book universe, which is where we spend most of our time. We also have characters like Penny Parker, who has more of an anime style, or Spider-Ham, who is more of a 2D cartoon Looney Tunes-ish style. Phil Lord and Chris Miller get a lot of the credit, although there are hundreds of animators that work on these movies, and they applied their same bag of tricks to Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, which yet again breaks totally new ground in the animation space than anyone ever thought possible, using so many different animation styles, so many different frame rates, and they use so many different techniques to make this movie one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my entire life. They use kind of watercolor painterly style, or the Indian Spider-Man style with Professor Parker. They use 2D animation, 3D animation, everything in between. It's just a glorious experience, and this movie uses the animation to elevate the emotion of the characters. All of these three points, the animation, the multiverse, and the characters, all bleed together, and that's why this movie is so well constructed, because all of the elements bleed together to form a beautifully crafted piece of art that is art in more ways than one, both in the story and the characters and in the animation style, which every frame of this movie deserves to be hung in a museum forever. In Spider-Gwen's universe, it has more of this watercolorly, painterly aspect, and the colors change and the background changes, and the environment has different styles. When the characters are portraying more emotions in the scenes, when Gwen is talking to her father and having these really heartfelt emotional moments where they're bearing their souls to each other. The animation style shifts and changes in the background, does all these crazy things to portray and elevate how we are visually representing the emotions of these characters. And it's very, very cool. The action sequences are so amazing. The animation style for Spider-Gwen's universe is super cool and unique and different. Totally different from Miles Morales' universe, Earth 1610, which has our same familiar comic book style, although kind of updated with the advancements in technology that have happened since the 5 years ago when Into the Spider-Verse came out, so it still looks absolutely beautiful. Professor Parker's universe looks incredible. The Indian Spider-Man's universe has a very distinct style to it as well as Hobie Brown, who is Spider-Punk. His kind of weird and wacky style also is very unique and different. There are so many spider people in this movie that it's kind of insane, and we'll get into that when we talk about the multiverse aspect of this movie. But everyone has their own distinct style, and even the sound department, I heard, use different web effects for every single character, and they improve them to show that they've matured from the last movie, which is a nice touch, and just shows the level of detail that the creators have put into this craft, to craft this amazing piece of art that has so many layers that we will probably never even know for years upon rewatch of this movie. I'm sure everyone's going to be discovering new things about it for a very long time. But hands down, the animation is some of the most beautiful animation that I've ever seen, some of the most beautiful animation that's ever been put to screen in this movie. I'm just gonna say it. It's the greatest animated movie ever created. And before I do say anything more, if you like this video, be sure to leave a like on this video and leave a comment down below who your favorite spider person is, as well as subscribe to my channel if you want to see more videos like this by me.
So wait a minute, there's an elite crew with all the best spider people in it?
Who's the new guy?
This is unbelievable.
This is the lobby.
Next up, let's talk about the multiverse aspect of this movie, how it laughs in the face of the MCU's Multiverse of Madness movie, and how it really shows how the multiverse is supposed to be properly used when you're introducing it in a superhero movie. In this movie, Miles Morales and Spider-Gwen both enter a portal and travel across the Spider-Verse to all these different dimensions, and they eventually end up in the Spider Society HQ in Nueva, New York in 2099's universe, where all of these spider people are gathered as they go off across the Spider-Verse to fix anomalies and try to save the multiverse from collapsing. There are so many Easter eggs, Donald Glover as the Prowler, video game Spider-Man, Spectacular Spider-Man, so many great little teases and Easter eggs. Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man and Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man both make an appearance from separate clips that have previously occurred, as well as the lady from Venom, the cashier lady, also makes a small little cameo in this movie. And this movie uses the Spider-Verse so well, to the fact where all of these big cameos all come from this one scene in the Spider Society, and in that scene, you're just looking around going, oh look, there's that person that I recognize, there's that person that I recognize. You're recognizing all of these spider people that you know and love, but what does it do? It elevates the main central arc and story of our main character Miles Morales, as well as Spider-Gwen, who is also just as much the main character as Miles Morales is, and it's used in a way to elevate this story. The story would not be nearly as exciting if you didn't see all of these spider people. What it does is it makes you believe in the fact that the Spider Society HQ and the Spider-Verse are really real in this movie, and the vast potential of what the Spider-Verse means. It's not used as just a way, like in No Way Home, to where many people had criticisms with the storyline of No Way Home, how it was kind of maybe a little iffy, maybe it wasn't completely thought through. The setup is a little, you know, flimsy. There's some holes you can poke in the storyline, but the nostalgia part of it, at the end when Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield come in and all the villains come in, the back half of that movie is so jam-packed with nostalgia, and it's great nostalgia. But what it's used for is a way to maybe distract you from the fact that the story has maybe a few holes in it. It's used as a way to go, hey, you know, we know this story isn't 100% fantastic, but look over here. We did this great thing over here with the nostalgia. Here's this person that you've known and seen before, this person that you love. Focus on that and neglect this other part. The story may not be 100% its greatest that it can possibly be. In this movie, the Spider-Verse aspect is used as an undercurrent. It's one scene where we're in the Spider Society. It's just one scene where we get to go and look, oh, who's that? Hey, that's that person. I know them. I recognize that person. Look at them. That's one scene in this vast overarching emotional current storyline that is very well thought through, very well written, a brilliant, fantastic, very tight script This movie is acclaimed on every rating website as one of the highest rated things in existence. The movie is making over $100 million at the box office in its first weekend, which is record breaking for an animated movie. People are absolutely eating this movie up. And why is that? Because in the first movie, we had such a great story with this character of Miles Morales that we spent time with, we got to know, we got to understand, we could get behind. So when it comes time for the second movie, we're behind the character of Miles Morales, we're with the character of Spider-Gwen, and when we get to explore more of what makes Spider-Gwen tick and what makes her the way she is, we get to see her side of her story. We are really connected with that character, and that comes first. That was the first thing in the filmmaker's mind, was how do we set up an interesting story with great characters, characters that you can relate to, characters that you can get behind, that feel real and feel authentic, that you can have an emotional connection to. And then we can take them on this story. We get to have the fun stuff with this one scene in the Spider Society. Tons of cool Easter eggs that people, you know, blows everyone's minds. The audience is going crazy for them. We get to have that. But first we have this emotional current. We have this story that works. We have the story that is thought through, has obviously been thought through for a long time. There are things in this movie that are revealed, like the fact that Miles Morales is kind of an anomaly because his spider that bit him was from another universe because of the Spot having an accident with the Kingpin's Collider. It was brought into Miles' universe and it bit him. That's kind of the main twist of the movie. That was set up in the first movie. The spider that bit Miles Morales, when it's crawling around in the subway tunnels, it's glitching out and it's doing that cellular decay thing that was realized in that movie. That's a sign that the person is not in their correct universe. This has all been thought through. The filmmakers really put tons of time and pour their heart and soul into crafting a story that really works. They know it works. It's brilliant, it's tight, it's amazing. And then you get to have the cool, fun stuff that doesn't take over the movie. It doesn't distract you from the holes in the story, but it elevates the story, it makes it better, and it gives it something cool, but also it doesn't detract from the better parts of this movie, because notice how the multiverse works in this movie. In Spider-Man No Way Home, the biggest standout moments are when Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire jump through those portals and they take off their masks and everyone in the theater was going crazy. I remember being in the theater, and that was one of the greatest theater experiences, probably the greatest theater experience of my life. Being in a room with people who are so ecstatic to see this character return, it was great, it was amazing, it was incredible. But in this movie, the biggest surprise, the biggest shocker, the biggest jaw-dropping moment of the movie does not come in the scene where we're in the Spider Society and we're looking at all these people that we've seen before. The biggest surprise and twist of this movie is when Miles Morales, first of all, realizes that he's in the wrong universe. He was been sent to Earth 42. Crazy. People in my theater just gasped. Everyone was going crazy. And then when he realizes that this version of himself is now the Prowler, craziest part of the movie. That part of the movie meant so much and it had such weight to it because we've been following this character, we've been following this story, and the story is so well written and it was something we were invested in. So the Spider Society stuff, it's cool and it adds to the story and we have some fun moments there. That whole scene where Miles Morales is running away from all the spider people, that's a great sequence and it's awesome. It's a great action sequence, but it's not the biggest part of the movie because it's not the main focus. It's there to have some fun. It's just a little sprinkles on top of the cake. The main gist of this movie is really with these characters who we spent so much time with and who we can really get behind and who we really appreciate and love.
Everyone keeps telling me how my story is supposed to go.
Speaking of these characters who we know and love so much, let's go ahead and move on to my third point, which is the characters of this movie / story of this movie. There's so many great new characters introduced in this movie, but there's also so much time spent with our old ones, these ones that we know. This movie is an animated movie, and I know that turns a lot of people off because people say animated movies are for kids primarily, and yes, that is true. This movie is rated PG, so you can take your whole family to see it. It's definitely, you know, kid friendly. It doesn't have too many profanities or innuendos or violence or anything like that. But the story is so mature. It's definitely not something that a lot of kids are going to understand because it's so complex and mature in the way it presents its story. The movie in the first half moves very slowly. We have a very long first act, really working on setting things up, establishing where we're going, what the journey is, what the story is going to be, what the point of it is. We spend a lot of time with these characters in the beginning. Spider-Gwen, the beginning intro with Gwen and her universe with Spider-Man 2099 and Jessica Drew taking down the Vulture and kind of, you know, setting up this movie. Also Gwen with her father. That part of the movie takes up long time. It's a long time, like 15-20 minutes before we finally get to the title credits, where we jump into back into catching up with Miles Morales, because it really takes the time to ground you in the reality of these characters' emotional journeys and really set up where they're going to go in this movie and in the next movie beyond the Spider-Verse. And it really just, it's really focused on getting you to connect with these characters, showing you how real they are, these emotions that they feel, these situations that they're in where they're forced to make choices that force them to grow and change and evolve and become the best versions of themselves. Gwen's story with her father is a very emotional and personal story. We spend a lot of time with her and her father understanding their relationship, understanding their situation that they're in, and really connecting with Gwen as a character and seeing her humanity, right? And understanding what her story is going to be. As well as Miles, we spend a lot of time in the beginning focusing on how he's struggling, balancing his Spider-Man life and his personal life with his parents, his struggle there with wanting to go off to college to study quantum physics so he can travel different dimensions just because he wants to see his friends again. Him as a character, the thing that he's really concerned about in this movie is he just really wants to see his friends again. And Into the Spider-Verse, he made this connection with Peter B. Parker and Gwen and Spider-Man Noir, Spider-Ham, Penny Parker, these friends that he made. He just wants to see them again. So his life dream is to go off to this college in New Jersey to study quantum physics to get to be able to travel dimensions to see his friends. Miles is not concerned with what other people think he can and cannot do. He wants to further his own potential. He knows what he's capable of, and he's not afraid to go out into the world and achieve those things that he knows he can achieve. He has this great ambition to go out into the world and do great big things, like his mom says. He's struggling with dealing with his responsibility as Spider-Man and his responsibility to the people that he loves the most. There's some undercurrents and themes of this movie about your responsibility to the people you love and the responsibility you have to everyone in the world. And Miles is kind of putting off the responsibility to everyone because he loves the people around him so much. He loves his friends. He loves his family. He just wants to be with his friends again. When Gwen returns to his universe, he can't believe it. He's so excited that he finally gets to see his friend again. And when he finds out that she wasn't really there because she wanted to see him, just because she was doing the job for the Spider Society, he's deeply hurt by that because he loves the people around him. And when he finds out that his dad is going to die in 2 days and he has the ability to stop it, he throws away all responsibility to anyone else just because he loves his dad. He loves his parents, he loves his family, and he's going to do anything that he can to save them. Because no one ever says it in this movie. I think they showed in the clips in the Spider Society, with great power comes great responsibility. But this movie really sets up a story where with great power comes great responsibility is the greatest dilemma in the entire movie. Because does Miles accept his responsibility to let this event play out? Or does he focus on the fact that he has the power to save his father, therefore he has the responsibility to save him from this death no matter the cost because he loves his dad? And that's a really powerful and engaging dilemma that Miles is faced with, these choices that he has to make of, does he just let his dad die because this algorithm says so? Or does he save his father because he knows that he can and he knows that it's his responsibility to save his dad because he has the power to? And this movie really just encapsulates the quintessential essence of Spider-Man. That's what makes the character so unique and so awesome. And Miles Morales as a character has been one of my favorite Marvel characters, and I think my favorite Marvel character for almost a decade when I discovered his amazing comics by Brian Michael Bendis. And this movie just really gets to shine his personality and his style and his character and his, you know, his line of thinking and his love of his friends, his family, and his humanity. He's just such a great character. His journey in this movie to push forward, to do the things that he knows he can do, and his love of his friends, and his relationship with Gwen is definitely blossoming. There's some romance there, maybe some flirting. It's very engaging to watch. I love the story between Miles and Gwen. That's definitely evolving, and we'll have to see where that goes and beyond the Spider-Verse. It's very well handled, and the Spot as a villain, I haven't even talked about him, I thought he was a great villain because Miles Morales was pushing off this responsibility of fighting the Spot because he loves his people so much. He loves his friends. He loves his family. He loves his parents. He had a responsibility to his parents, so he neglected this other responsibility. He was, you know, torn between the push and the pull and the tug of being Spider-Man and being Miles Morales. So he left this responsibility unchecked, and he didn't pay the Spot any mind just because he wanted to be with his friends and family. So because he neglected that responsibility, the Spot became more and more powerful. He gave him a drive to become a bigger villain. Even though the Spot doesn't necessarily have, you know, the strongest motivations or the most evil villain origin stories ever, his motivation to just be able to beat Spider-Man was very charming and likable. The way that Lord and Miller have this amazing ability to make jokes at just the right moments. that remind you of story points. The jokes are kind of, you dismiss them because they're jokes, like, oh, that was funny, I remember that, but it's probably not that important. But they use them as ways to remind you of significant story points, and they wrap pivotal moments in just jokes, like the spot's a funny, silly character, but he really becomes more and more of a threat as the movie goes on. And he's still a silly character. He's not like evil or you know, threatening or anything. He gets very threatening by the end of the movie. But he's still just kind of this silly, campy personality, but he has a very real danger to our main Spider-Man, because as we learn, you know, as we get more into the third act from Miguel O'Hara, that is, he's going to kill Miles' father. And also Miguel O'Hara as a character, very good. All of the new characters are great. Professor Parker, Spider-Punk, aka Hobie Brown, great, great characters. They're all just, they have their distinct personalities. The voice cast is great. They're all just fantastic characters. So all in all, the characters in this movie are just so well written because they're pushing their stories forward. They're making choices that are making them into better people, and they're making choices that are pushing their story forward and causing them to change and evolve and grow. That's just really great to see. And the characters, the multiverse aspects, and the animation all tie together and to make this beautiful package of animated history that's just, I'm glad I get to be alive to see it in the theater, because it's just, it's so iconic and it's so memorable and it's so innovative and it's just making history, this movie. It's truly a beautiful thing to witness. I'm sure if you've seen the movie, you definitely know what I'm talking about, because it's amazing. It's a truly an awesome experience. And the twist at the end is just so awesome, so well played, so just such an amazing writing that, you know, uses the multiverse as a way to further the story and make it interesting, something unexpected, something I had no idea was coming, and it was just beautiful to see on the big screen. So, that about concludes it. That's why Spider-Verse is definitely one of the greatest movies ever made. It's phenomenal, it's awesome. If you haven't seen it yet, I don't know why you're here, but you should definitely go check it out, because it's absolutely incredible. And definitely, I've seen it twice already, and I will be watching it many more times before Spider-Man Beyond the Spider-Verse comes out. I know we all will be very excited to see that on the big screen in March. So if you enjoyed this video, make sure to comment down below who your favorite Spider-Person is, or what you thought about everything I said in this video. I would love to hear your thoughts, and make sure to leave a like on this video if you did like it. Share it with a friend, maybe, if you can. And subscribe to my channel if you want to see more videos like this. I'll be talking about other Marvel movies and such. This movie truly is something special. You don't get many movies like this these days. You can click right here on my face to see another video by me, and I will see you guys in my next video.